today. We thank you for your presence here with us. Lord, as we worship you together, and as we hear from our children, and as we see their joy, and as we see their worship, I pray, Father, that our hearts will open to worship you more and more in spirit and in truth. Help us to follow you, first of all, and to love one another, and to rejoice that you are our Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thanks for pinch hitting. Give them a chance to the Father today. Father, as we bow in your presence, it's with thankful hearts. Thankful hearts for your love to us. Father, we pray for all these new people that have given their heart to Christ lately. Help us to be faithful as a church, to receive them, to love them, to build them up in faith, and to encourage them. Father, encourage them in the fact that we all have sadness, we all have fears, we all have anxieties, we're all human. But in you, we find strength. In you, we find comfort. In you, we find peace. In you, most of all, we find hope. Help us to stand together as your church. Help us to stand together as your people and to build one another up in love. And Father, I do pray for Billy. I pray that you would help him physically. And Father, we've asked that you give him a measure of health for as long as we can have him. We covet the fact that he'll someday spend forever with you, and we want him here with us. Forgive us for that. But we do love him. And I'm so thankful that he made that choice and was baptized to show his willingness to follow after you and to receive you for salvation. I pray, Father, that others who are coming to you will stand in that same faith and will never, never waver. Help us all to grow deeper. Help us all to come closer. Help us all to love more. And as we continue in this service, we give you the glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Is someone's coming to read? Eunice is coming to read today. I'm just going to switch the camera here so you can hear her read scripture. Thank you, Eunice. It's only been 2 or 3 months ago I shared from this same portion of Scripture, this same sequence of text, but I focused on the earlier part. I focused on Martha's story. There's another story in this text, and it's the story of Mary. You might remember that I had shared how Martha, who was the one who had been so busy that she wasn't connecting with Jesus, that she wasn't sitting at his feet. Jesus chided her and said, "Martha, Mary has chosen the good part, which will not be taken away from her." But even Mary, the close friend of Jesus, the disciple of Jesus, as she is known in the early church, because with men and women there was no difference in the early church. Women were leaders. women were accepted in leadership. And Mary had been the one sitting at Jesus' feet, taking it all in, and you would think ready for anything. I shared before about what it meant if the man of the household died in their culture. All his goods would be sold, including his house, and the property, the value of that, would go to the nearest male relative. And so these two women were facing a life of being destitute, perhaps starving to death, unless for the good graces of their family, or should they find another husband. That was the culture Jesus came to. That was the people Jesus came to redeem. But Martha had gone out to Jesus and said, "Lord, I believe." Somewhere between the time when Jesus chided her to plug in, to connect, she had connected to the point that her deep faith got her up out of her chair, and she heard that Jesus was coming. She went to meet him. And she said the same words Mary said: "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." Isn't that so human of us? That's the first thing that happens to us when something terrible happens. Well, if God had done something, this wouldn't have happened. The point I'd like to make is that we put limits on what God is actually doing. We make statements like that and say, the world's in a mess. If God had done something here, this would not have happened. If that virus had never got into the world, 4 million people would not have died. And we fail to see what God's actually doing. I've heard reports across the church and across many other churches. In fact, 4 or 5 of our churches recently got together for a baptism. And there's more people coming to Christ than I've seen in a lot of my lifetime. Are we failing to see what God is really doing when he's at work? I know the reality is horrible. If you start to think of 4 million families, some 4 million represented with the grief they would have for the loss of a loved one, it's horrendous. And yet grief and trouble happens in our world today. Terrible things happen. And I've shared about this some lately. But here was one of Jesus' best friends saying, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Can you imagine how deep that would cut the heart of Christ? The one who loved humanity. The one who loved his enemies. And here was a friend saying, "If only you had been here. If only you had been here." There are times in our world when God seems distant. To the point that some people think that he's some kind of absentee landlord. You know, he put the world in motion and he left. And here we are, in some kind of mess. The fact is, Isaiah prophesied some 700 years ago, some 700 years before Christ came, that would be almost 3,000 years ago, and he said, his name will be called Emmanuel. Not just any name, but God with us. God with us came into this world, lived among us for a while, and when he left, he said, "I'm leaving so I can send the Holy Spirit. Not so I can just be with my friends over here in Bethany, but so that the Holy Spirit can be with you and with you and with you and even with the people online around the world." There's no lockdown that can separate us from the love of Christ. There's no trouble. There's no anxiety. There's no sickness, no disease, nothing that we get in trouble with. then we continue on and we think we know the limits and we try to speak into the limits of what God is doing. But the children learned this week, I don't know if you saw it flash up in that video, their memory verse was Ephesians 3:20. And it's written in Scripture as a blessing on the church. And it's a blessing to our heart if we listen to the words of it. The meat of that text says, God is able to do immeasurably more than we can ask or even imagine. Do we believe that? It's not just a failing to see. Sometimes we limit God with what we say and what we think. The call in this text is to remove obstacles. First, he spoke to Martha on the way. He told her, I am the resurrection and the life. Do you believe this? Do you believe that he is the resurrection and the life? Or do we live in a world where we think that everything is going downhill? I'm over 50, so it's pretty easy to say that. Some people that are 20, 25, 30, some of the people out running today think they're invincible. But the human condition is things tend to go downhill. We live in a broken world. But we put obstacles in God's way that includes a lot of different things. Not just the realities, the human realities we live. But so one of the things that we put in God's way is the guilt. The way that we react to this broken world and do things that we regret. Do things to hurt others. Do things to make things worse. When I was 20-something and when someone shared the gospel with me, I felt like I was in a mud pit with a shovel, and the further I dug, the deeper it got. And that's exactly what it was. The harder I dug, the deeper it was. And the guilt that I carried, I didn't pay attention to it, but the guilt that I carried was real. And there were things that I said and did that can't be undone. And only God's forgiveness can take that away. But if you think you're the only one in that condition, if you think that, in fact, there's a lot of people on this island, I've had conversations where they think they have to straighten their life out and then they can come to God and be presentable. That's not salvation. That's religion, trying to fix yourself. Salvation is when God comes into your heart and life and transforms you from the inside out. If you let him do salvation in your life, you'll be changed. If you try to do religion, nothing will ever change. It will always stay the same. The guilt will always be there. Isaiah said, there's no one righteous, not even one. But then he told of the hope of a righteous one who would come. That there would be a man, an anointed one. And from that text came the word Messiah. When we use that, it means anointed one of God, who is able to take away, John the Baptizer said, able to take away the sin of the world. See, the fact is, Paul explained in Romans 5 and 8, while we were yet sinners, while we were still in our sin, Christ died for us. He looked ahead and saw where your heart and life was. Maybe today, broken in sin. Maybe you remember those days and you received salvation into your life. But when you were broken in your sin, Paul went on further to say, when we were his enemies, he was our friend. And he died for us. There's other obstacles that get in the way, things like procrastination. That's what they thought Jesus was doing when he didn't come. But he had looked at his disciples and said, this sickness isn't unto death, it's for the glory of God. He looked at them again And they were probably saying, we need to go. Lazarus is really sick. They've sent a messenger. He's really, really sick. Jesus said he's sleeping. He knew that Lazarus had already died. But the procrastination that we tend to put in the way of salvation is, well, when I get older, I'll have time for it. When I start my job, when I get my job settled, and you fill in the blank, I've got to work this hard. It's dumping day, and I can't think about it for the next 4 or 5 months. And maybe this summer. And then summer comes. Well, in the fall, I'll have time. But in the fall, it's gunning season and hunting season and dumping day again. And life goes by. I've talked to a lot of people in the 3 years I've been here who have followed that cycle. People that really intend to follow after Christ. But they put the obstacle of procrastination in the way. Then there's people that put the obstacle of pride. Well, I'm a good person. I'm better than anyone that goes to West Head Church. Why do I need salvation? Well, I beg to differ. Billy needed salvation, and I never heard a bad word about Billy. If you did, I'd love to know. Not that I want to hear gossip, but I never heard a single ill word about Billy Newell. And yet he came to a point where he realized that only Christ can make us presentable to God. I'm so glad he did. And no matter what takes place in his physical body, heaven's forever. Heaven is just, I don't know what forever means to you. I remember thinking as a child, what does forever mean? What does everlasting life mean? I had heard those things, but I watched as older family members grew older and as some of them passed away, and that was the end for me. That's all we see. But forever means that just when we think the end is coming, it starts all over again. I can't say it any better than that. I can't think of forever because I can tell you what day I was born. And if the Lord tarries, someday people will put a note, a year on my tombstone. We're not forever in this world. But we will live forever somewhere. Those stones get in the way. Stones of other people. Not only the pride of I'm good enough, but look at those people. Well, even that pastor at West Head. You know, I've had at least 5 people say to my face, some pastor you are. And I kind of want to put that on a medal and wear it. Some pastor you are, because it's usually in the context of teasing, joking around. And I love to have a good yarn and love to have a good time with people and to connect with people and to know them. There are a lot of good people outside these doors. And I really wish the marathon was on a Saturday so that I could go and be a volunteer and get to know a few more people. Because the more people I meet in this place, the more I love the people and the place. There are beautiful people outside our doors who need to know that they need salvation. There are stones that get in the way, things like self-consciousness. In fact, I've had a couple people since I moved here who have come to Christ and no one knew it. And this week again, one of those people. And when I have permission, I'll share it with you. But let's give thanks that yet another person has placed their trust in Christ. But don't, if you're one of those people that's private, that's shy, don't let that get in the way of you accepting Christ and becoming fully accepted as a part of our church family. It's It's not for show. But I love to get up here and say a name of a person, yet another person who has joined me in following the Master. And as we follow Christ together, God will build his kingdom in us and through us. Christ came with them, and when he saw their grief, when he realized how final they felt it was, when they realized that he was 4 days in the grave, and they didn't even want to roll away the stone. They were self-conscious. Like, don't roll away the stone. He's been in there 4 days in 40-degree heat. It'll stink. And some people are that way. They don't want people to know the hurt and the brokenness they've lived. But there is nothing that God will not forgive. There is no one that God will not accept because of the sacrifice of Christ. And he spoke to them and said, if you'd like to roll away the stone. No, he spoke in the authority and power of God and said, roll away the stone. And if there's something in your life today, a stone, either of pride, of self-consciousness, of other people, of thinking that you're good enough, roll away the stone in your life and acknowledge that you need salvation. Because until you roll away the stone, the miracle doesn't happen. Could it have happened? Yes. Could it happen? God could impose salvation on us, but then it wouldn't be human choice. And the fact is, he created us to worship him by choice. And then the irony of it all, we don't have strong enough willpower to do it on our own. We need him even for that. But the miracle can happen if we roll away the stones and remove what we can. I've heard it described this way. We take a small human-sized step towards him, and he takes a God-sized step towards us. That's the reality of it. Everything that we turn over to him, he moves in the power of his Holy Spirit to transform us more than we could ever imagine. Maybe there's someone here today that's been considering following Christ. Maybe there's someone here today that you made that decision in your heart, but you've never told anyone. I'm on Messenger. My cell phone number, it's not up on the screen, but it's 902-635-3683. I'd like you to either text me or send me a message today if you've made that choice. And give me permission, please, to share it so that we can pray for you and pray with you and help you, because we're all human. We all need to grow in Christ. And Karen and I watched a lot of children raise their hands this week, and Deneen led them and asked them. I just heard about it. I was in there. I should have been out here watching. But I hope that in the weeks and months to come, some of our tweens that are in that children's group and some of the tweens that have aged out of our VBS program and out of our Sunday school, that we're now reconnecting through this pool party and through the corn boil. You say, oh, that doesn't sound like a lot of fun. Well, I'm asking everybody to join in and be there for these events so that we can reconnect our children more and more to our church, so that together we can build them up in faith. And maybe when you come to the beach, when we do the corn boil, maybe you're not into the games and things the kids are playing. Maybe you just want to take a walk on the beach and stay for corn boil for supper. But I trust you'll be blessed in coming too. And every child that will be there, every tween that will be there, needs as many grandparents, as many parents, as many mentors in the faith as we can give them as a church. That's every one of us. And so let's go into the rest of this summer and let's remove the stones in our life to accept faith. Do you have another song to do at the end? If the worship team wants to come back, I'm just going to ask you if you bow your heads right now. And I'm going to pray for you. And if you're making that decision today to follow Christ, send me that message on Messenger. Send me a text. Give me a call if you don't have either text or Messenger. And we need to get together and talk about that profession of faith. Maybe you've done it in the last 2 or 3 years since we've been here. We need to talk about it. And you need to make it public so that we can help you as you follow the Master. Let's pray. Father, as we bow in your presence today, I thank you for your word, and I thank you for the fact that you told them to roll away the stones, and that the miracle happened, that you called Lazarus from a grave where he'd been for 4 days. Impossible, says our world. You are able, God, to do immeasurably more than we could ask or even imagine. Father, we pray for others in our church that are facing health issues, facing faith crises, facing family issues, facing trouble of any kind, whether it's personal, financial. Father, we ask that you would intervene and work miracles in our lives. And may our hope be in you. May we all come to know you as the author, the person who initiates our salvation. And may our trust and hope be in you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you all to stand. Karen's going to lead us in a song as we close the service.
Romans 6, 4 to 7 says, therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead, through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in the newness of life. For we have become united with him in the likeness of his death. Certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. For he who has died, this next song is called Resurrection Power. And it talks about how Christ has called us from the grave just like Lazarus. And he's giving a new life to us. All we have to do is accept it. with us. Our chains